Schwarzköpfchen. So, first one. Prosecution. Note, suffering prosecution is being maltreated by others because you are a true disciple of Christ. Suffering persecution is being maltreated by others because you are a true disciple of Christ, and it includes being falsely accused, unjustly condemned or imprisoned, being ridiculed, scorned, rejected, or injured. Persecution is not suffering for doing wrong toward others or for disobeying rightful authority. Why do people persecute Christians even when they are doing good? John chapter 15, verse 18, verse 21. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it will love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10, verse 14. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, suffering. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, in Iconium, in Lystra, the persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil men and opposers will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. First John chapter 3, verse 1. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, what we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Cain persecuted his brother Abel because his own works were evil, while Abel's were righteous. Genesis chapter 4, verse 2, verse 7. 1 John chapter 3, verse 12, verse 14. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one, and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil, and his brothers were righteous. Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life, because we love our brothers. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Do good, and pray for those who persecute you, and love your enemies. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38, verse 42. You have heard that it said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if someone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. If someone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Matthew chapter 5, 43, verse 45. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil people and the good ones, and sends rain on the righteous people and on the unrighteous people. Romans chapter 12, verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Imitate Stephen, who prayed for his persecutors as they were stoning him to death. Acts chapter 7, verse 60. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep. In dealing with your persecutors, you want to be wise and you want to be innocent. Matthew chapter 10, verse 16. I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. If you are falsely accused, trust God to lead you. Matthew chapter 10, verse 70, verse 20. Be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to the local councils and flog you in their synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witness to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say for it. It will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking for you. One needs not to get depressed due to severe persecution. Paul testifies to that. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8, verse 9. We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. Second Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, verse 29, Paul tells of the many things he suffered at the hands of his persecutors. Those who suffer for the sake of Christ will be blessed and should count it an honor to do so. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, verse 16, dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you know that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are assaulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal, or even as a murderer. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. Never be ashamed to identify with those who are being persecuted. Rather, suffer with them if they need be. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8, verse 9. Do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord, or ashamed of me, his prisoner, but join me in the suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. Do not be ashamed of the gospel. Testify boldly and be ready to suffer persecution. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3. Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, verse 10. Remember Jesus Christ raised from the dead, descending from David. This is my gospel for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain that salvation that is in Christ Jesus with the eternal glory. Some compromise the gospel to avoid persecution. Don't be like that. Galatians chapter 6, verse 12. Those who want to make a good impression outwardly are trying to compel you to be circumcised. The only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. If persecutors threaten you, obey God rather than man, as did Peter and John. Acts chapter 4, verse 18, 20. Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, judge for yourself whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. For we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. The apostles went on preaching the gospel. Acts chapter 5, verse 17, verse 32. Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than men. So it says, this is what it says, unconverted unbelievers that don't have their faith in Christ, sinners they are, will at times heap abuse on you because you no longer join them in their sin. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 3, verse 5, you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans do, what pagans choose to do. Living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable adultery, they think it strange that you do not plunge with them into the same flood of dissipation, and they heap abuse on you. Yep, I've seen it. But they will have to give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. So this is called sex life. Sex is God-given. Read Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4. Marriage should be honored by all. In the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer in all the sexual immoral. Fulfill your duty to your spouse. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 3. The husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband. Your body also belongs to your spouse. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 4. The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but is also to his wife. find sad affection in your spouse. Proverbs chapter 5, verse 18, 20. May your foundation, may your fountain be blessed, and may you rejoice in your wife of your youth, a loving though a grateful dear. May her breast satisfy you always. May you ever be captivated by her love. Why be captivated, my son, by an adulteress? Why embrace the bosom of another man's wife? Mixed marriages. Don't be yoked with an unbeliever. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, verse 16. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness or wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light with darkness have harmony in? What harmony is there between Christ and Bela? What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. So we cannot walk together unless they are agreed. Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so. There are sad results of mixed marriages prior to the flood in Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, verse 4. God's people are warned against mixed marriages. Unbelievers will lead them to sin. Exodus chapter 34, verse 16. When you choose some of their daughters as wives for your sons, and those daughters prostitute themselves to their gods, they will lead your sons to do the same. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 3, verse 4. Do not intermarry with them, the heathen. Do not give your daughters to their sons, or take their daughters for your sons, for they will turn your sons away from following me to serve other gods. And the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will quickly destroy you. God will reveal his anger if and when his people marry unbelievers. Joshua chapter 23, verse 12, verse 13. If you turn away and ally yourself with the survivors of these nations that refrain among you, and if you intermarry with them and associate with them, then you may be sure that the Lord your God will no longer drive out these nations before you. Instead, they will become snares and traps for you, whips on your backs and thorns in your eyes, until you perish from this good land which the Lord your God has given you. So the Bible is a collection of 66 documents inspired by God. These documents are gathered into two testaments. The Old Testament 39 and the New Testament 27. Prophets, priests, kings, and leaders from the nation of Israel wrote the Old Testament books in Hebrew with two passages in Aramaic. The apostles and their associates wrote the New Testament books in Greek, and the Old Testament begins with the creation of the universe and closes about 400 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. The history of the Old Testament creation of the universe fought a man flood over the whole earth, and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Israel, fathers of the chosen nation. The history of Israel begins exile in Egypt 40 through 30 years, Exodus in the wilderness wanderings in 40 years, and conquest of Canaan 7 years, era of Judges 350 years, United Kingdom Saul, David, Solomon 110 years, Divided Kingdom Judah, Israel 350 years, and exile in Babylon 70 years. The details of the Old Testament history are explained in the 39 books, which are divided into 5 categories. Return and building and land, 140 years. The law of 5 books, Genesis to Deuteronomy. History, 12 books, Joshua, Esther. Wisdom, 5 books, Job, son of Solomon. Major prophets, 5 books, Isaiah, Daniel. And minor prophets are the 12 books, Hosea, Malachi. Prelude and history of the New Testament. After the completion of the Old Testament, there were 400 years of silence during which God did not speak or inspire any scripture. That silence was broken by the arrival of John the Baptist, who announced that the promised Savior had come. While the 39 Old Testament books focus on the history of Israel and the promise of the coming Savior, the 27 New Testament books focus on the person of Christ and the establishment of the church. The 4 Gospels give the record of his birth, life, death, resurrection, and ascension. Each of the 4 writers views the greatest and most important event in history, the life of Jesus Christ, from a different perspective. Matthew looks at him through his kingdom, Mark through his servanthood, Luke through his humanity, and John through his deity. The book of Acts, the story of the impact of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, his ascension, the coming of the Holy Spirit, the birth of the church in the early years of the gospel preaching by the apostles and their associates. The 21 epistles or letters were written to the church and individuals to teach about the person and work of Jesus Christ and how to live and witness until he returns. The New Testament closes with Revelation, which begins by addressing the current church age and culminates with the prophecies of Christ's return, when he will establish his earthly kingdom and bring judgment on the ungodly and bless his believers. Following Christ's millennium reign will be the last judgment, in which all believers of all time will enter the ultimate eternal glory prepared for them, and all the ungodly will be consigned to eternal punishment in hell. The central theme, the one unifying theme unfolding throughout the whole Bible, is that his own glory God has chosen to create and gather to himself a group of people who will live in his eternal kingdom to praise, honor, and serve him. Forever and through whom he will display his wisdom, power, mercy, grace, and glory. To gather his chosen ones, God must redeem them from sin. The Bible reveals God's plan for the redemption from its origin in eternity past to its completion in eternity future. All covenants and errors are secondary to the one continuous plan of redemption. There is one God who is creator and Lord. The Bible is one book. It offers one plan of grace recorded from its intentation and creation through its fulfillment in Christ to its completion in Revelation. The Bible is the story of God's redeeming his chosen people for his glory. As God's redemption purposes and plan unfold in Scripture, five recruiting motifs are constantly phrased: the character of God, the judgment for sin, and disobedience. The blessing for faith in obedience, the sacrifice of the Lord's Savior for sin, the glory of the coming kingdom. Everything revealed in both the Old Testament and the New Testament falls into these five categories. As one studies Scripture, it is essential to grasp these recurring themes and shape all of the passages, and to recognize that what is introduced in the Old Testament is also clarified in the New Testament. The revelation of the character of God. Above all else, Scripture is God's self-revelation. In that self-revelation is established his standard of absolute holiness because of his holy character. From Adam and Eve, the standard of righteousness has established and is sustaining through the last page of the New Testament. The revelation of divine judgment for sin and disobedience. Scripture repeatedly deals with the matter of human sin. Of the 1,189 chapters in the Bible, only 4 do not involve a falling world. The first 2 and the last 2, before the fall in Eden and after the creation of the new heaven and new earth, the rest is the chronicle of the tragedy of sin. In the Old Testament, God showed the disaster of sin, starting with Adam and Eve to Cain and Abel. The relentless record shows the continued devastation produced by sin. In the New Testament, the tragedy of sin becomes clear as Jesus issues a call to repentance. Disobedience is even more flagrant than in the Old Testament because it involves the rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ in the brighter light of New Testament truth. The revelation of divine blessing for faith and obedience. Scripture repeatedly promises wonderful rewards in this life and in eternity to those who trust and seek to obey God. In the Old Testament, God showed the blessings of repentance, faith, and obedience. As seen in the lives of Abel, the patriarchs, the remnant in Israel, and even the Gentiles who believed, such as the people of Nineveh. In the New Testament, God showed the blessedness of redemption for those who responded to the preaching of John the Baptist, Jesus and the apostles, to all those and to all who were believed through all history, there is a blessing promised in the world to come. The revelation of the Savior and his sacrifice for sin. This is the heart of both the Old Testament and the New Testament. The promise of the blessing is dependent upon grace and mercy for the sinner. Such forgiveness is dependent upon a payment of sin's penalty to satisfy God's holy justice. That requires a substitute, one to die in the sinner's place. God chosen the substitute, the only one who qualified, is Jesus. Salvation is always by the same gracious means, whether during Old Testament or New Testament times. When any sinner repents, convinced he has no power to save himself from the judgment he deserves and pleads for mercy, God grants him forgiveness. God then declares him righteous because Christ's sacrifice covers him. In the Old Testament, God justifies sinners that same way in anticipation of Christ's atoning work. Therefore, there is a continuity of grace and salvation through all of redemption history. Having fulfilled all righteousness by his perfect life, Christ fulfilled justice by his death. Thus, God himself atoned for our sin at a very high price. That is what the scripture means when it speaks of salvation by grace. The glory of Christ in his kingdom, as in any book, how the story ends in the most crucial and compelling part. So with the Bible, redemption history is controlled by God so as to accumulate in his eternal glory. Scripture notes several very specific features of the end plan by God. The Old Testament repeatedly mentions a kingdom ruled by the Messiah, accompanied by the salvation of Israel, the salvation of Gentiles, the renewal of the earth from the effects of the curse, and the bodily resurrection of God's people who have died. Finally, the Old Testament predicts the creation of a new heaven and a new earth, which will be eternal state of the godly and a final hell for the ungodly. In the New Testament, these features are clarified and expanded. The king will return in glory, bringing judgment, resurrection, and his kingdom for all who believe. The Lord will reign in the renewed earth, exercising power over the whole world and receiving due honor and worship. Following that kingdom will come the dissolution of the renewed but still sin-stained creation, in the subsequent creation of a new heaven and a new earth, which will be the eternal dwelling of those who believe. To understand these five themes reveals the glorious pattern of the Bible. With these in mind, the Bible will unfold not as 66 separate documents or even two separate testaments, but as one book by one divine author who wrote it, all with one overarching theme. My prayer is that the magnificent and overwhelming theme of the redemption of sinners for glory of God will carry every reader with captivating interest from beginning to end of the story. Christian, this is your story. It is from God for you, about you. It tells what he has planned for you, why he made you, what you were, what you have become in Christ, and what he has prepared for you in eternal glory. Considering the human tendency to doubt God, is common for a person to be skeptical of the authenticity of the Bible, considering its bold claim to be the only true word of God. Many minds have struggled with valid questions such as these. Where did the Bible originate? Who wrote the Bible, God or man? Has scripture been protected from human tampering over the centuries? How close to the original manuscripts are today's translations? How did the Bible get to our time and language? If the scripture were written over a period of 1500 years, about 1405 BC to AD 95, passed down since then for almost 2000 years and translated into several thousand languages, what prevented the Bible from being changed by the carelessness or ill motives of men? A study of the scriptures alone settles all the questions to the intent that someone need to never be bothered by them again. Scripture gives the assurance. The scripture self-acclaims, take the Bible and let it speak for itself. Does it claim to be God's word? Yes.
Over 2,000 times in the Old Testament alone, the Bible asserts that God spoke what is written within its pages. From the beginning, Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, to the end of Malachi chapter 4, verse 3, and continually throughout, this is what the scripture claims. Passages in the Bible make a powerful statement about the Bible, setting it apart from any other religious instruction ever known in the history of mankind. Its context marks it as sacred, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, and holy, Romans chapter 1, verse 2. The Bible claims ultimate spiritual authority in the doctrine, correction, and instruction because it represents the inspired word of Almighty God. Scripture asserts its spiritual sufficiency so much so that it claims exclusively for its teaching. See Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11, and 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, verse 4. God's word declares that it is inerrant. Psalms chapter 12, verse 6. And infallible. Chapter 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, verse 17. It is true and therefore trustworthy. All of these qualities are dependent on the fact that all scripture are God-given. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, verse 21, which guarantees its quality, its source, and at its original written. God took the initiative to reveal himself to mankind. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. Sometimes through the created order, visions and dreams, or speaking prophets. However, the most complete and understandable self-disclosures or through the proportions of scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, verse 16. The revealed and written word of God is unique in that it is the only revelation of God that is complete and that so clearly declares man's sinfulness and God's perversion of the Savior. The revelation of God was captured in the writings of scripture by means of inspiration. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Peter explains the process, knowing this first, that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of men, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, verse 21. Through the work of the Holy Spirit, the Word of God was protected from human error. We must understand that the Bible is actually one book with one divine author. Though it was written over a period of 1,500 years through the pens of almost 40 human writers. The Bible begins with the creation account of Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, written by Moses about 140-05 BC, and attends to the eternally future account of Revelation 21-22, written by the Apostle John about AD 95. But this raises a significant question. How was it determined which sacred writings were to be included in the canon of scripture and which ones were to be excluded? Over the centuries, three widely recognized principles were used to validate those writings that were divinely inspired. First, the writing had to have a recognized prophet or apostle as its author, or one associated with them, as in the case of Mark, Luke, Hebrews, and James, and Jude. Second, the writing could not disagree with or contradict previous scripture. Third, the writing had to have a general consensus by the church as an inspired book. God anticipated man's and Satan's malice toward the scripture with divine promises to reverse his word. The very continued existence of scripture is guaranteed in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. See 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 25. This even means that no inspired scripture has been lost in the past and still awaits recovery. The battle for the Bible rages, but scripture has and will continue to outlast its enemies. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing which I send it. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11. Through the centuries, the practitioners of textual criticism, a precise science, have discovered, preserved, cataloged, evaluated, and published an amazing array of biblical manuscripts from both the Old and the New Testament. In fact, the number of existing biblical manuscripts dramatically outdistance the existing fragments of any other ancient literature. By comparing text with text, the textual critic can confidently determine what the original prophet apostolic inspired writing contained. For example, discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1947 and 1956 manuscripts that are dated about 200 and 100 BC proved to be marvelously important. After comparing the earlier Hebrew texts with the later ones, only a few slight variants were discovered, none of which changed the meaning of any passage. Although the Old Testament had been translated and copied for centuries, the latest version has essentially the same as the earlier ones. The New Testament findings are even more decisive because a much larger amount of material is available for study. There are over 5,000 Greek New Testament manuscripts and range from the Old Testament to scraps of papyrus containing as little as part of one verse. A few existing fragments date back to within 50 years of the original writing. The New Testament textual scholars have generally concluded that 99.99% of the original writings have been reclaimed, and 2 of the remaining 100th of the percent, there are no variants substantially affecting any Christian doctrine. God intended his word to abide forever, preservation. Therefore, his written self-disclosure revelation has protected from error in its original writing inspiration, and collected in the 66 books of the Old Testament and New Testament canon. Through the centuries, 10,000s of copies and thousands of translations have been made, transmission which did not introduce minutes. Did not introduce minute errors, because there is an abundance of existing ancient Old Testament and New Testament manuscripts. However, the exact science of textual criticism has been able to reclaim the content of the original writings. Revelation and inspiration to the extreme degree of 99.99% of the meaning remaining 101% have no effect on its content per preservation. The sacred book which we read and obey deserves to undeservedly be called the Bible, since its author is God, and it bears the qualities of total truth and complete trustworthiness that also characterizes its divine source. How do we know that God will not amend our current Bible with a 66-7th aspired book? In other words, is the canon forever closed? The most compelling text on the closed canon is the scripture to which nothing has been added for 1900 years. For I testify to everyone who hears the words of prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plaques that are written in this book. And then if anyone takes away from the words of this book of this prophecy, God should take away his heart from the book of life, from the holy city and from the city which are written in this book, Revelation chapter 22, verse 18, verse 19. The book contains the mind of God, the state of man, the way of salvation, the doom of sinners, and the happiness of believers. Read it to be wise. Believe it to be saved. And practice it to be holy. It contains light to direct you, food to support you, and comfort to cheer you. It is the traveler's map, the pilgrim's staff, the pilot's compass, the soldier's sword, in the Christian's character. It should fulfill the memory, rule the heart, and guide the feet. Read it slowly, frequently, and prayerfully. For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you receive the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcome it, not as the word of men, but as it is truth in truth. The word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. First Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. Why is God's word so important? Because it contains God's will for your life. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, verse 17. The Bible is the only source of absolute divine authority for you as a servant of Jesus Christ. Consider the following description claims from Scripture. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Psalms chapter 19, verse 7. Every word of God is pure. He is shield to those who put their trust in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you, and you be found a liar. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5, verse 6. For I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plaques that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of this book, of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book, Revelation chapter 22, verse 18, verse 19. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11. What are the basics of Bible study? The idea of personal Bible study is simple, but requires discipline and long-term goals. I want to share with you 5 steps for Bible study that will give you a pattern to follow. Develop a plan of how you will approach reading through the Bible. Unlike most books, you will probably not read it straight through from cover to cover. There are quite a number of good Bible reading plans that will help you read the Bible. Systematically, read a passage of Scripture repeating until you understand its theme, meaning the main truth of the passage. For example, in the Old Testament, I would suggest you read it straight through, spread over time, since that is a significant reading project. Do not feel overwhelmed. Simply try to find the truths that God has revealed for you to learn. In the New Testament, you may want to take a more repetitive approach. You can read one of the numerous times in a row so that you will retain what you have read. Try to begin with a short book such as John, 1 John, and read it 5 chapters carefully through in one sitting. After you have finished, begin again reading 1 John every day for 30 days. At the end, at the time, you will really know what is in the book. As we read scripture, always keep in mind one simple question of what does this mean? Let the Holy Spirit be your teacher. 1 John chapter 2, verse 27, for this is the book that he offers. Pray for wisdom to understand the meaning and read diligently as you interpret scripture. Several common errors should be avoided. Do not draw any conclusions at the price of proper interpretation. That is, do not make the Bible say what you want it to say, but rather let it say what God intended. Avoid superficial interpretation. You have heard people say to me, this passage means, or I feel it is saying. Recognize that between your time and the biblical time, you must bridge cultural, geographical, and historical gaps. These gaps do not integrate biblical truth, but you will understand the message much more clearly if you understand the context in which it was written. Do not spiritualize the passage, interpret it, and understand the passage in its normal literal historical grammar new sense, just as you would understand any other piece of literature you are reading today. Four principles should guide us as we interpret the Bible, literal, historiographical, and sapphic. The literal principle scripture should be understood in its literal, normal, and natural sense. While the Bible does contain figures of speech and symbols, they were intended to convey literature truth. In general, the Bible speaks in literature terms, and we must allow it to speak for itself. History principle. We must ask what the text meant to the people to whom it was written, first written. In this way, we can develop a proper contextual understanding of the original intent of scripture. The grammatical principle. Ask simple questions about the basic structure to whom do the pronouns refer. What is the tense of the main verb? Simple details like these, the meaning of the text clear. The Sophists, the Reformers, called this analogic of scripture, meaning that the Bible does not contradict itself. If interpretation of one passage contradicts a truth taught elsewhere in the scriptures, our interpretation cannot be correct. Scripture must be compared with scripture to discover its full meaning. Studying scripture without allowing it to penetrate the depths of your soul would be like preparing a banquet without sitting down to eat and enjoy it. Ask the ultimate question, how do divine truths apply to my attitude and actions? Jesus made this promise to those who would carry their personal Bible study through to this point. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. John chapter 14 verse 17. Having read and interpreted the Bible, you should have a basic understanding of what the Bible says and what it means by what it says. But studying the Bible does not stop there. The ultimate goal should be to hear its message and to grow spirituality. That requires a personal application. Bible study is not complete until we ask ourselves, what does this mean for my life and how can I practically apply it? We must take the knowledge we have gained from our reading and draw our practical principles that apply to our personal lives. If there is a command to be obeyed, we obey it. If there is a promise to be embraced, we claim it. If there is a warning to be followed, we heed it. This is the ultimate step. We submit to scripture and let it transfer our lives. If you skip this step, you will never enjoy your Bible study, and the Bible will never change your life.
finally make connections between the doctrine you have learned in a particular passage with the dying truths and principle taught elsewhere in the Bible to form the big picture. Always keep in mind that the Bible is a single book in 66 parts, and its truths are taught over and over again in a variety of stories and principles. By corroborating and cross-referencing, you will begin to build a sound doctrinal foundation. It is not enough just to study the Bible. We must meditate upon it and immerse ourselves in the purifying solution of God's Word. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Genesis covers a longer span of history than any other book of the Bible. God started everything. The Bible doesn't begin with an argument for God's existence. It begins by accepting that our existence depends on God. The ancient Greek translation of the Bible called the Spekula or LX titled this first book Genesis, meaning origins. Eventually, English translators borrowed the word directly. The title used in Hebrew text simply highlights the very first word, which means in the beginning, written by Moses approximately 144.5 to 104.05 BC. Although Genesis does not name its author in the evidence described in the text and almost three centuries before their birth, both the Old Testament and New Testament designate Moses as the author. In addition to Moses' educational background, makes him the likely candidate. Acts chapter 7 verse 22. No comparing reason have been for common challenge. Mosaic authorship. Key people in Genesis are Adam and Eve, the original human beings. Noah, the faithful builder of the ark. Abraham and Sarah, the parents of a nation called God's chosen people. Isaac and Rebecca, the original members of a new nation. Jacob, the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. Joseph, the preserver of his people and nation of Egypt. To intercede for Genesis, the attorney passed God by willful act, and divine word spoke all creation into existence. Furnish it and finally breathe life into a lump of dirt. that he fashioned in his image to become Adam. God made this human the crowning point of his creation. That is commandment, who would enjoy fellowship with him and bring glory to his name. Genesis has three distinct and sequential geographical settings. MESOPOTAMI, the promised land, Egypt. The time frames of these three segments are creation, most of the central teachings of Christianity have their roots in the book of Genesis. God the Father, the authority of God in creation. Psalms 103:19, 1 Corinthians chapter 8:6. God is one. God is one yet three, the Trinity. Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4, Isaiah chapter 45 verse 5 verse 7, and Matthew 28 verse 19, 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 4 verse 2, and 2 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 14. Human beings created in Christ's image yet fallen into sin and need a Savior. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 7, Romans chapter 8 verse 29, Colossians chapter 1 verse 16. God is the creator. God is faithful and keeps his promise. God is just. God is long-suffering. God is loving. God is merciful. God is upholding. God is powerful. God is prudent. God is truthful. God is wrathful. Jesus' entrance into humanity was planned from before the beginning of time. God potentially mitigated the curse that resulted from the sin of Adam and Eve by offering a promise that someday a seed would rise up to crush the serpent, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Even though the death came through Adam, Christ's coming brought life to humankind, Romans chapter 5, verse 12, verse 21. Genesis goes to trace the first lines in God's divine blueprint for Jesus' birth from the peoples of the earth. God singled out Abraham's to be the father of a chosen nation. This nation continued through Abraham's son Isaac, and then through Isaac's son Jacob, concluding with the account of Jacob's son Joseph. Genesis reveals God's continued protection over the earliest people in Christ's lineage. God's Hebrew plural, Elohim, Elohim. The most used Hebrew term for God, the basic meaning is the Almighty, Almighty. The Hebrew usage of the term in Genesis is called the plural of majesty, unlike a normal plural. The Hebrew uses the plural to mean the fullness of deity or God, very God. The plural form of this word was transitionally being recognized as indicating the plural nature of God. God is one, but God is also three distinct persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Heavens, Hebrew, Shamayim. The Hebrew word for heavens may refer to the physical heavens, the sky, the atmosphere of earth, or to the dwelling place of God, Psalms chapter 14, verse 2. The spiritual heaven, the expression is related to the term for it to be high, lofty. The physical heavens of creation testify to God's glorious portion and also to his creative genius. Psalms chapter 19, verse 6. The land, Hebrew, erects. The common Old Testament word land possesses several shades of meaning. In essence, of land belongs to God as its creator. Psalms chapter 24, verse 1. When God promised the Israelites the land of Canaan, it was his to give. The land of Canaan was so representative of God's covenant with the Israelites that it became one of their indefying characteristics, the people of the land. The seed, Hebrew, zerah. The Hebrew word for seed can literally mean a plant seed, or can frequently mean one's descendants. In Genesis, it refers specifically to the common Messiah, and God's promise that the woman's seed would crush the serpent. Numbers chapter 24, verse 7, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, Isaiah chapter 6, verse 14, Galatians chapter 3, verse 16, as such as a term, takes on great importance in the Bible. Through Abraham's seed, both collectively in Israel and singularly in Christ, would reach out to save his people. How does the Bible challenge or agree with the scientific theories? Scientific theories, by their very definition, are subject to change and adjustment. Scripture remains as God revealed, unchanging declaration of truth. The Bible was not written as a challenge to any particular scientific theory, but scientific theories have often been designed to challenge or undermine biblical statements. They either agree with scripture or are mistaken. Description in 1 verse 1 Genesis that God created the heavens and the earth yields 3 basic conclusions. Creation was a recent event measured in thousands, not millions of years ago. Creation was ex nihilo, meaning that God created it out of nothing. Creation was a special, with light and time being the first of God's creative acts since the day count began before the creation of the sun and moon. What do Christians mean when they talk about the fall? The fall refers to the moment in time when human beings first disobeyed God. Chapter 3 tells the painful episode what Eve set into motion. Adam confirmed and completed by joining her. They sinned together. The willful decision of Adam and Eve created a state of rebelling between the creation and her creator. In the fall, our first ancestors declared us on Satan's side. The Bible makes it clear that the fall brought sin into every subsequent person's life. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Our capacity for sin is unborn. We are sinners before we have the opportunity to sin. Not only are we sinners because we sin, we first sin because we are sinners.
Why? Because we have all inherited the effects of Adam's fall. How significant is the flood in the overall biblical history? The Bible treats the flood as a worldwide event directly brought by God as a judgment on the sin of humanity. The flood hangs like a warning cloud over all of the subsequent history. Fortunately, that cloud also holds a rainbow of God's promised grace. The flood illustrates several important aspects of God's character and God's relationship with his creation. 1. God retains ultimate control of world events. 2. God can and will judge sin. 3. God can and does exercise grace even in judgment. 4. An even more universal and final judgment will be carried out on the world based on God's timetable. Why did God cause multiplication of languages in the dispersing of persons in Genesis? After the flood, human assimilation again began to spread across the earth, and later the people decided to establish a city as a tribute to themselves and as a way to keep from spreading across the earth. This was a double prideful rebellion against God. First, their city, with its proposed tower, was to be a monument to their self-reliance. Second, the pyramids of their settlement represented an effort to disobey God's direct command to inhabit the whole earth. Because God's purpose to fill the earth with custodians, he responded to the people's prideful rebellion. They had chosen to settle. He forced them to scatter. Their cooperation and self-reliance had been based on their shared language. Instead of using all of their resources to obey God, they misused them for disobedience. God chose to complicate communication by multiplying the languages. The location where this confusion took place became then known as Babel, related to a Hebrew word meaning to confuse. Later it became Babylon, the constant enemy of God's people, and throughout scripture, the capital of human rebellion against God. Revelation chapter 16, verse 19. Revelation chapter 17, verse 5.